Well, good morning to everybody. I do want to welcome you to church this morning and those joining us online. Today is the first Sunday of daylight saving time, so some people may be coming in just a little bit late, but regardless, we are glad that you are here this day and glad that you are joining us online. Don't forget to text your presence in church today by dialing that number that's on your bulletin insert. And then if this is your first Sunday here, type in the word connect, C-O-N-N-E-C-T. If you're a member, you're here all the time, just type in the word here, H-E-R-E, and we can then get in touch with you. Methodism 101 continues today in the chapel. I invite you to come and learn what it means to be a United Methodist Christian. Our churchwide Bible study for Lent continues this evening. It's lasting for 4 weeks. I'm leading the study. It's entitled The I Am Sayings of Jesus. We have a meal at 5:30. It's going to be pork tacos this evening, and our study's at 6 p.m. Our new bishop, Bishop Williamson, is coming to Lake Charles this Wednesday, March the 15th. She's going to meet with the clergy of the church here at the Worship Center at 10 a.m. and all of the laity, that's you, at 6 p.m. at St. Luke Simpson on Country Club Road. This will be a great opportunity to meet the new bishop and to get to know her, so I hope that many of you come to that. Our young adult class continues today. It'll be at 10 a.m. They're starting a new topic on the five love languages. It'll meet in room 106. We come now to our opening prayer and the lighting of the Christ candle. Let us pray. Mighty God, everything that you do shows us your glory and your majesty. I pray that you'll open our eyes to see what you are doing in our lives. As we gather together in your name, we pray that you will fill our hearts and our minds and our souls and change us, Lord, and make us more like you. In his holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Weldon, for that prayer this morning. What he said at the end of it, a lot of the songs that we're singing this morning are about that, God making a change in our lives and making us someone more like him, more having more of the attributes of God. Let's stand together, everyone. I know it. It's early. It's daylight saving time, Sunday. I almost started stuttering because my brain is like, you know, it's very jumbled. But God is worthy of our praise this morning. Go ahead.
Grace for me will always be
more than enough,
the power of Jesus Christ in me is
more than enough,
because my heart is full and my soul is free. In my weakness you had a plan for me, and I can't stop singing about your love. No, I can't stop singing about your love. Jesus, forever you'll be more than enough. And I can't stop. No, I can't stop. Oh, 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 oh. We'll provide, you will supply. Open heaven, open wide, you are
more than enough,
because my heart is full and my soul is free. In my weakness you had a plan for me, and I can't stop
singing about your love.
No, I can't
stop singing about your love.
Jesus, forever you will be. Your part right here. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Sing it with us. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. full, and my soul is free. In my weakness, you had a plan for me. Now I sing a song angels cannot sing. I have been reborn, I have been redeemed, and I can't stop
singing about your love.
No, I can't stop
singing about your
love. I want the world to know.
If I sing but don't have love, I'll waste my breath with every song I bring. An empty voice, a hollow noise. If I speak with a silver tongue, convince a crowd, but I don't have love, I leave a bitter taste with every word I say. So let
proof of your love. Let my love look like you.
Oh, and what you're
made of.
How you live, how you died. Love is sacrifice. So
let my life be the proof.
The proof of your
more time, sing it with us, declare it. I want my life.
Let my life be the proof.
The proof of your
and I want my love,
love
to look like you, God.
My love look like you.
And what you're made of. How you live, how you die. Love is sacrifice. So
let my life be the proof.
The proof of your
for the children's story right up here at the front of the church. Miss Ann has a good message for you and a little treat for you. So come on up, kids.
Well, I'm counting the weeks down because on Palm Sunday in the afternoon, we're having an Easter egg hunt, and it's going to be extra special, man. So if you have your eggs, put them on the a place where we leave all our goodies for everybody, and we'll bring them upstairs. Well, you know, boys and girls, I brought a little plant today. And this is a little aloe vera plant. It's little, but if I keep watering it and taking good care of it, it won't be long. I'll have to get a bigger pot because it'll start getting real big. How many of you have ever seen like a fruit tree, like an orange tree? And when the oranges, when the tree gets to a certain size and you go outside and you see these blooms and then you see oranges growing on it. But you know that in the Bible, it talks about a fig tree. In my backyard is a fig tree. And one day my neighbor came over and he said, "Hey, Ann, you mind if I take care of your fig tree for you?" I said, "Well, no, because it looks like it needs some taking care of." And he said, "Well, I'm going to fertilize it this year, and I'm going to put some extra stuff around it because I want to see if we can get some fruit, if we can see the figs." Jesus talked about that in the Bible. There was a little fig tree growing, and the man that owned the property said, "Just cut it down." And the gardener said, "Oh, no, 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 no. Let's let it grow. Be patient. Let's be kind to it and water it. Give it extra food so it will grow." And you know what, boys and girls? That's what God does for you. He sends you your moms, dads, grandparents, aunts, uncles, all our friends, and he says, "We're going to give you all this love, and we're going to take good care of you so you can live like Jesus." And he said, and guess what? You don't have to wait till you get this big to bear the fruit. He said, "You can share my love with others all the time." So let's go out. Let's start today. And let's go out and share the love of God with everyone. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, thank you for the love that you give to us. Thank you for the support system that you supply. Lord, let us go out now and share your love with others. Amen.
Thank you, Miss Ann, for sharing that children's sermon with us this morning. A great reminder of us wanting to share God's love with everyone. And don't forget what you mentioned. You can still bring in those stuffed Easter eggs for the kids. We're going to continue worshiping God this morning through song as we prepare our hearts for prayer. I know this is a song that we all know. Let's sing it together.
Your power and love as we sing. Open the eyes, open the eyes of my heart.
I want to see
in everyone, everywhere, to see you.
If you would please join me in prayer this morning. Father, we come to you today full of gratitude, full of love, and in awe of your love for us. We thank you, Father, for waking us up, for getting us here, Lord, for leading us each and every day of our lives, for showing us signs all around us that you are there, that you are God, and that you are Almighty. Father, this morning we come to listen to your word, to offer you our praise and our tithes. We ask, Father, that you change us, that you help us to show others your love and your mercy. Help us, Father, to walk each day with eyes that you have given us to see those around us that are hurting, that need your love and your mercy. I thank you, Father, for the opportunity and for the privilege of being able to come here anytime we want in freedom so that we can joyfully give back to you just a tiny bit of the love that you share to us. I thank you, Father, for those in our church that need you, Lord. That's each and every one of us. Those that are sick, those that are in times of just trouble and stress, I ask, Father, that you would meet them where they are, that you would help those around them, touch them, and meet their needs. But mostly, Father, I ask that you would just anoint them with your supernatural grace and peace and the assurance that you are there and that you are in control, despite the look of the circumstances. Help us this morning, Father, as we humbly come before you to pray like your Son taught us to pray, as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Pace, for that prayer this morning. Brother Weldon is drawing close to the end of a sermon series, The Master Teacher Teaching with Parables. And I'm so excited about this parable that we're going to hear today. Excited about what God has given Brother Weldon to share with us this morning. As we sing this next song, you know, it's a prayer. And I imagine similarly to the heart of the character that we're going to hear about today in this parable, what a wonderful message it's going to share for us to look within ourselves, to examine our relationships with God, and to think about how we can grow it and what it means to us. If you can, sing along with us. Let the words of it minister to you this morning.
Jesus, I've forgotten the words that you have spoken, promises that burn within my heart have now grown dim. With a doubting heart, I'll follow the paths of earthly wisdom. Forgive me for my unbelief, renew the fire again. Lord, have mercy on me. I have built an altar where I've worshipped things of man. And I have taken journeys that have drawn me far from you. Now I am returning to your mercies ever flowing. Would you pardon my transgressions? Help me love you again.
Sing it with us if you can.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
This morning's scripture comes from the book of Luke, so if you are able, please stand while we read from the Gospel of Luke. Thank you. I'm going to be reading from chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. As I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated.
I like the story about a very pious church member who went to visit the children's Sunday school class one Sunday morning, and this holy, pious church member stood before the kids in a very pompous way, and he asked them a question. Why do you think people call me a Christian? There was an awkward silence in the room, till way in the back of the classroom, a little boy raised his hand, and he said, because they don't know you? In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, Jesus talked about two men who came to the temple to pray. Now, the first man called himself a holy man. He was a Pharisee. He had everything going for him in life. He was a good man. In fact, he was better than good. He goes way beyond the call of duty. He was very holy. He was very devout. That's the first man who came to the temple to pray. The second man was a tax collector. He's sometimes called a publican, not a republican, but a publican. Back in the days of Jesus, the tax collectors were cheaters, they were frauds, they were thieves. He was the tax man, and everybody just despised all the tax collectors. He was even considered to be an outcast. Zondervan commentary said it like this in these few sentences. The tax collectors were the most hated members of Jewish society because of their reputation for embezzlement and their complicity with the Roman oppressors. The very presence of a tax collector in the temple, the house of God, was viewed as an act of defilement. So two men are in the temple that day, a holy Pharisee and a hated tax collector. Imagine for a second that those two guys are here at First United Methodist Church of Lake Charles this morning, and they've come up to the front to pray. So here they are up at the front of the church. The first man, who's so holy and so devout and so righteous, prays like this. He prays out loud, Dear Lord, I give thanks that I am not like other people. And then he gets very specific and very personal. He says, I thank you, Lord, that I'm not greedy or dishonest or an adulterer or anything bad. And then he gets even more specific. And I thank you, Lord, that I'm not like that guy over there. I'm not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give 10% of all my income to the temple. I am a good man. That's his prayer. It's like God was supposed to be impressed with him. Then very smug and satisfied, he goes back to his seat. The other guy over here at the altar, this guy who's basically a bad guy in the eyes of everyone else, bows his head, he beats on his chest, and he cries out, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. That's it. That was his prayer. According to the Greek, he's praying, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. Not just a sinner, but God, be merciful to me, the sinner. That's all he said. But then Jesus said very clearly, this man who asked for mercy was forgiven, and not the other man. I want you to know that statement of Jesus really got their attention. They were not expecting him to say that. This morning, as I read this parable, as I think about it, I hear a strong message from the Lord about arrogance, about thinking and believing that we are really something very special, about thinking and believing that we are a little bit better than other people. Scripture calls it the sin of pride. It's believing that we are better than other people. A man by the name of Christian Herter was the governor of Massachusetts several years ago. He was campaigning for a second term in office. This one day after a busy morning of campaigning, no lunch, he arrived at a church barbecue. As the governor moved down the serving line with his plate, he came to the woman serving chicken, and she put a piece of chicken in his plate, and he said, I'm really hungry. Could I have a second piece of chicken? And she said, no, the rule is one piece of chicken per person. He said, but I'm really hungry. Just two pieces of chicken. He said, I'm sorry, sir, that's the rule. One piece of chicken per person. Well, he hated to throw his weight around, but he did. He looked at her and he said, do you know who I am? I'm the governor of Massachusetts. Could I have a second piece of chicken? And she looked at him and said, do you know who I am? I'm the woman in charge of the chicken. Move on, mister. The Pharisee in the story of Jesus claimed to be so good. He claimed to be so holy. In his prayer, he was actually bragging to God about how good he was. Here's how Jesus said it. He prayed to himself. And that to me says a lot. He prayed to himself. He stood by himself. According to him, he was way above and beyond everybody else. He was too good to be saved. He was arrogant. You know, sometimes, unfortunately, in the eyes of the world out there, churches come across like that. Sometimes. Some churches come across like that. The attitude that says, well, here at this church, we have it all figured out. We have the Bible all figured out. In fact, we have God all figured out. Here, we know the answers. And they give the impression that they are above and beyond everyone else. That is arrogance. This morning, it's so easy to be like that Pharisee and to concentrate and point to the sins of other people and talk about them and how bad they are. It's so easy to be like that Pharisee and try to compare ourselves to other people. And then we feel better about it. We say, well, at least I'm better than that person. Well, at least I haven't done that. In writing this sermon for today, I thought back to Saturday Night Live several years ago and to the church lady. Do you remember the church lady? She would say, well, isn't that special? Smug and self-satisfied and better than everyone else in our own mind. The Christian writer and theologian C.S. Lewis once said, a proud man is always looking down on things and down on people. And of course, as long as you are looking down, you cannot see something that is above you. So here's the truth. If anybody here this morning really believes that he or she has it all together, if anyone here today really believes that he's just perfect and everything in his life is A-OK and you have no faults, I hate to say it, but there's something terribly wrong with that person spiritually. The famous evangelist Dwight Moody said it quite bluntly. He said, God has nothing to say to the self-righteous unless we humble ourselves before God and confess before God our iniquities and our sins, the gate of heaven is forever shut against us. The Pharisee in our story for today had no conception of that. He was perfect. He was holy. He was smug. He was self-righteous. He was way above everybody else, or so he thought. But the tax collector, on the other hand, was honest before God, and he begged for mercy. He begged for forgiveness. And Jesus said he found forgiveness and not the other man. You know, sometimes today, unfortunately, we are a little bit like that Pharisee in the story, and we look down on other people. The Pharisee came to the temple to pray, but he couldn't stand the tax collector. That's quite obvious from his prayer. And sometimes today in churches, our attitude is this: I hate the sin, and I really hate the sinner. In the Gospel of John, chapter 8, some very self-righteous men dragged before Jesus one day a woman caught in the act of committing adultery. They had stones in their hand, and they were ready to stone her to death according to the law. And they asked Jesus what they should do. Jesus said this profound thing. He said, those of you who've never sinned, go ahead and throw the first stone. They got all quiet. And one by one, they dropped the stones, and they walked away. This parable of Jesus teaches a very important truth. Here it is. God accepts us as we are. If I come to God today and I'm honest before God about my sins and my failures and my shortcomings and I ask God for mercy, God hears that prayer and God answers that prayer. I love the hymn, and we'll sing it at the 11 o'clock service, just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. Just as I am, that's the way that we come to the Lord. So here he is at the altar of the church, this hated tax collector. He's beating on his chest, and his prayer is so simple. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. He wasn't playing games. He wasn't faking and acting. He wasn't just going through the motions. He prayed, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And God forgave him and accepted him as he was. Several months ago, I was having a great meal at the Rotary Club on a recent Tuesday at the Pioneer Club. Now, I had two problems that day. I had a long sleeve, starched white shirt, and I was eating meatloaf for lunch that had gravy, tomato gravy. And you can guess what happened. So all day long, everybody could see what I had for lunch by just looking at my shirt. Perhaps somebody here this morning or somebody watching online has a different kind of stain. It's in your life. A stain that's far worse, a black stain on our soul. It's on the inside, a serious blemish in our character. And we try so hard to clean that stain, but it just won't go away. But here's the great news of our faith. That dark stain in our lives can finally be cleansed by Almighty God. It's so important that we understand this. We can't earn that salvation. We can't buy it. We certainly will never deserve it. It comes to us by the grace of God alone. I want us to hear what the Apostle Paul said in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 8. Paul said, for by grace are you saved through faith. It is not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. I'm so thankful today that God offers to each one of us here this morning, like he did for the tax collector, another chance at life. God offers to each one of us the incredible gift of mercy. The tax collector just prayed, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I wrote something for the local newspaper last year about a time when I was 16 years old, and I worked as a busboy at Don's Seafood in downtown Lafayette. Almost every night, working as a busboy in that restaurant, I would look for table scraps for my dog, Noonie, our family dog, and I would get pieces of ground meat and steak and put it in a paper bag and bring it home to her, and she was always so happy to see me. Well, this one night, I was behind the counter looking at the dining room, and this man was eating his meal, and he got up and he left. And I looked at his plate, and he had half of a steak on there, the most expensive steak in the house, a ribeye steak, and half of it was still there. I thought, oh, man, my dog is going to love this. So I went to the table. I got the steak. I put it in the paper bag, wrapped it up. I turned around and went to get my tray to clean his table, and then I saw the horrible sight of that man coming back to his table. He had just gone to the bathroom. He had this puzzled look on his face because his steak wasn't there. Of course, I took his steak. So I had to work up the courage, and I went to him, and I told him what I'd done, and I was so sorry. And then with even more courage, I went to the manager, and I said, Mr. Jimmy, I took this guy's steak for the dog. And he frowned, and he said, go to the kitchen and order another steak. I'm surprised to this day that I was not fired on the spot. I'm surprised to this day that I didn't have to pay for that steak out of my pocket. To a 16-year-old busboy, let me tell you, that was grace. That was mercy. It was something undeserved, unexpected, unearned. It was a touch of mercy and a second chance for somebody who needed it badly. I'm so thankful today that God offers to each one of us a second chance. The gift of grace. And the scripture says that's the only way to find salvation. The tax collector prayed, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I love the old story about an elderly pastor. He was a faithful preacher of the gospel. He was very sick. He was on his deathbed, didn't have long to live. He invited a good friend of his to come to visit him and to read to him from the scripture. His friend came to his bedside, and he opened the Bible to the Gospel of John, chapter 14, and he began reading, in my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. But the old preacher stopped him, and he said, no, that's too good for me. Open it to Luke, chapter 18. And he did. And then he began reading these words, and the tax collector, standing afar off, would not lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat upon his chest and prayed, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I want you to know this morning, that is my prayer. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And I hope that's the prayer for all of us. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for this marvelous story that Jesus told. I pray, Lord, that the truth of this story will really come through to each one of us, that we don't deserve it, we can't buy it, we can never earn it, but that you offer to us the gift of mercy and forgiveness and a second chance. So, Lord, we come to you this day, and deep in our heart, we say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Hear our prayer this day in Christ's name. Amen. And now we affirm our faith together through the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let us stand as we do so. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Please be seated as we come to the morning offering.
Sing it with us. My Savior.
My Savior.
Please stand. As we close this morning, I invite you to give your heart and life to Christ if you've never done so in an open and public way, to come before us as I do and as you do so often, and to say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I invite you to join First United Methodist Church of Lake Charles. Do what God is leading you to do this day as we close in worship together.
'Cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son. 'Cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live,
the Father's only Son.
Oh, and you live, and you die.
I do hope you come back this evening. We have our meal at 5:30. It's going to be pork tacos. It's going to be really good. And our study from 6 to about 6:45 on the I Am Sayings of Jesus tonight is on I Am the Bread of Life. We had such a good crowd last week. I invite you to come and join us this evening in Paxton Hall. Only two parables are left. Next Sunday, the parable of two sorry sons. Now, this is not about the prodigal son. It's a different parable that Jesus told about a dad and his two sorry sons. Then the following week about rich man and Lazarus. Hope you have a great week. Look forward to seeing you soon. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you this day and to give you peace. Amen.